Respected Dean Dr. T. R. Subramania, sir, our beloved Vice Principal Professor Praneshwaran, sir, all the faculty members of CMR University School of Legal Studies, and my beloved friends. I, on behalf of CMR University School of Legal Studies, would like to extend our heartfelt welcome to our respected speaker of the day, Honorable Justice Mr. H. Billappa, sir. Honorable Justice Mr. H. Billappa, sir, is a former judge of High Court of Karnataka. Sir did his bachelor's in science at Chitradurga Government College and pursued his LLB at RL Law College, Davanagere. Justice Billappa, sir, enrolled himself at the Bar Council in the year 1978. He has more than 25 years of experience and practice in the legal profession. Further, Billappa, sir, has also worked as a faculty at Vivekananda Law College, Seshadripuram Law College, and Renukacharya Law College. In the year 2003, he was appointed as an additional judge of Karnataka High Court, and in 2004, got appointed as a permanent judge. In the year 2016, he got his retirement. During his legal service, he has dealt with many cases related to KSRTC and TTC institutions. Adding to his achievements, sir has done many works on Kannada literature. And even after his retirement, he is still involved in serving the public. Sir, I welcome you once again to share your valuable insights on the topic and overview on the examination of witnesses. We are sure that this would be a very good learning experience for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Vandana. Bentham states that witness are the eyes and ears of justice. The criminal justice system consists of three important components, that is the law enforcers, judiciary, and correctional institutions. In this regard, the witness plays an important role in assisting the court in dispensing justice. The substance of a criminal case is the evidence, and the witness helps in unfolding the intricacies involved in a particular case. Hence, a systematic approach towards the examination of witness is an integral part involved in establishing a case. Examination of a witness plays a key role in the presentation of evidence in a court of law, regardless of the character of the case, that is civil or criminal. Examination of witness is an important principle in which the witness takes a stand of his or her words for the protection of the integrity of evidence. It is very important as a part of criminal and civil trial. There are various types of witnesses who assist in concluding the trial for delivering justice. There are child witness, interested witness, eyewitness, hostile witness, related witness, independent witness, solitary witness, material witness, trap witness, expert witness, and official witness. Under the Indian criminal administration system, the examination of a witness has been discussed under the three main codes, the CPC, Code of Criminal Procedure Code, CRPC, and Indian Evidence Act. In today's session, Justice Billappa, sir, shall give us an overview of the examination of witness by referring to the above mentioned codes. Over to you, sir.
So, I can start, isn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
Yes. Respected Vice Principal, respected Dean, sir, respected law professors, and dear students, and all the participants in this webinar. I am extremely happy to deliver my lecture on this topic, examination of witnesses. This is really a very important and interesting topic because it concerns the litigants, it concerns the lawyers, it concerns the law professors and law students. So therefore, it's a very interesting subject. We must know the Cardinal Principles of Evidence Act. The three cardinal principles of Evidence Act are that the best evidence must be produced before the court, the hearsay evidence must be excluded, and the evidence adduced in a particular case must be relevant and relates to the fact in issue and the relevant facts. These are the cardinal principles. Just assume for a moment that if hearsay evidence is excluded and before the court for its decision, the best possible evidence which is relevant to the matter is before the court, and how easy it is for a lawyer to argue the case and how easy it is for a judge to make his decisions. Therefore, a judge or court of law makes decisions based on proved facts. How we can prove a fact? A fact can be proved by oral evidence, by documentary evidence, by admissions, by confessions, by presumptions, and other things like material objects, etc. To lead evidence means to examine witnesses. Therefore, examination of witnesses, be it a civil case or a criminal case, plays a very, very important role. Therefore, we need to know how to lead evidence of the witnesses. And the scope of different kinds of examinations, like examination in chief, cross-examination, re-examination. What is the scope of these kinds of examinations? Before that, let's know who can testify before the court, who can be a competent witness. There is no restriction in the Evidence Act. Any person can be a witness in the court of law, provided he satisfies two things. One, he must be capable of understanding the question put to him. And second thing is, he must be able to give rational answer. These are the two criteria, that the person is capable of understanding the question to him, and then he answers those questions rationally. If this is satisfied, then anybody can be a witness. Because of age, tender age, or because of old age, or because of mental or physical disease, a person may not be able to understand the question put to him, then he cannot be a witness at all. If he is because of a very young age, if a witness is not capable of understanding the question to him and give rational answer. So also, a person who is aged is unable to understand the question put to him and give rational answers, or because of physical or mental disability, a person is not capable of giving rational answers or understanding the questions. Such persons cannot be examined as witnesses. Barring those persons, all persons, even a deaf and dumb, a man who cannot speak also can give evidence in the court. How he can give evidence? He must make it intelligible by whatever means. Say he can, whatever he wants to depose before the court, he can put it in writing or by signs also. So interpretation, educators, court can appoint some person who can understand that language, sign language, and then it will be interpreted, or it can be videographed how actually that person who is deaf and dumb, who is unable to speak, can give evidence. Therefore, even a lunatic, can he? Yes, he has also sane intervals. If he is capable of understanding the question put to him and give rational answers, that is the test. A lunatic also can be a witness in the court of law. So therefore, any person except a person who is unable to understand the question put to him and giving rational answers, all other persons can be examined as witnesses in the court of law. Now the next question is, what is the order? How we need to examine those persons, and what governs these things? How to produce a witness or to examine a witness? Means, for civil cases, there is what is known as civil procedure code that governs, tells us how civil proceedings should be conducted and how witnesses needs to be examined in civil cases. Similarly, in criminal cases, criminal procedure code is there that controls, that governs the examination. Maybe at times the law prevailing may not answer these circumstances, then experience will come to our help. So whatever experience tells, that will guide us, who is to be examined first, who is to be examined last, which witness needs to be examined, which witness cannot be examined or need not be examined. All this will be either first, if there is law, civil proceedings and criminal proceedings, now they are governed by civil procedure code and criminal procedure code. If those procedure codes will not answer, then practice and ultimately the discretion of the court. So all these ways are used. We will go to civil procedure code. If it does not help us in a particular case, then we'll go by practice or experience. That also will not, then court by its discretion will say, guide us what is to be done, which witness needs to be examined, how it needs to be examined. So therefore, production and examination of witnesses, wherever possible, is governed by the procedure codes and also practice. In the absence of that, the discretion of the court, that is how witnesses are produced and examined. Now, how to test their relevancy or admissibility of evidence? So if that is not curbed, all sorts of evidence will go into record. Therefore, it is the discretion or duty of the court which records evidence to ask the witness for what purpose a particular witness is going to be examined. And then, if the court feels yes, his evidence is relevant, then it can take a decision and admit the evidence. Therefore, the admissibility and relevancy of the evidence, or which fact must be proved before proving a particular fact, all this will be decided by the court depending upon the circumstances. It can also sometimes say, take the other person, that I am going to adduce evidence regarding a particular fact at a later stage. If court is convinced about that, it can do like that. Otherwise, it can call upon the particular party to prove a particular fact before leading evidence in respect of some other fact. Or the relevancy of some fact, if it depends upon proof of some other fact, first that fact must be proved. We can take one or two examples. Say, for example, dying declaration. Dying declaration is a statement made by a diseased person as to the cause of his death. A dying man makes a statement as to the cause of his death. Suppose the man who has made this statement survives, he will not die at all. So therefore, that statement, if the person who has made the statement survives, cannot be used as a dying declaration at all, because he can be summoned to the court, he can be examined, cross-examined and re-examined. So he can testify before the court. But the person who makes a statement with regard to the cause of his death dies, then his statement can be used as dying declaration. So first, if somebody wants to prove, or the prosecution say wants to prove dying declaration, first it must prove that the man who has made the statement is no more and he has died. Unless that death of that person is proved, dying declaration cannot be proved. Similarly, take one more example. Say there are cases when the original document is lost or destroyed or not within the reach of the person or could not be found. These are the possible life circumstances. Then what is to be done? If the original document is, which is so valuable, is not available at all, or it is in possession of somebody else, or it is not found, or it is burnt, it is not in existence, then what is to be done? Law provides for secondary evidence. If original evidence, that is the best evidence. If original cannot be produced, straight away we can't lead secondary evidence. We must make out a case to produce secondary evidence. So we must first account for why a particular party is not able to produce the original evidence. If it satisfies, convinces the court that it is a case for secondary evidence, then only court can allow that person to produce secondary evidence. Otherwise, unless a ground is made out, I have original, but I only want to produce copy of it, that is not permissible at all. Because law says the best evidence must be produced for court's consideration. So in such cases, court will decide in its discretion whether it should allow a particular party to lead evidence or to prove a particular fact before adducing evidence in respect of some other fact. That is purely left to the court. Court can say, I am not going to allow you to lead evidence in respect of this fact unless this fact is first established. Or court can ensure itself that he is going to prove that fact, subject to that only the evidence is received. It is for the discretion of the court. Court can pass appropriate orders insofar as relevancy and admissibility of the evidence is concerned. Then the order of examination, that is in fact today's topic, how witnesses needs to be examined. So a witness is going to be examined by the party who calls him to the court as a witness, and he is going to be examined by the opposite party or the adverse party, and again he is going to be re-examined by the party who calls him. Then only we can say the examination of witness is total and complete. That means a party who calls the witness examines first. That we call it examination in chief. That means examination of the witness by the party who calls the witness to the court is called examination in chief. And the examination of the witness by the adverse party or the opposite party is called cross examination. And again, after cross examination, if there are any doubts, clarification is required, then the party who calls the witness to the court can re-examine and clarify, explain things. That is called re-examination. Therefore, examination of witness means three things. One, examination in chief. Second, cross examination. Third, re-examination. If all these things happen, maybe in a given case a witness need not be re-examined, or in a given case witness need not be cross-examined if his cross-examination is not required. But in the normal circumstances, usually examination of witness means it is examination in chief and cross examination and re-examination. That is the total or the complete evidence of the witness. Now let's know the scope of the examination of all these things. That's very, very important now. What is the scope of examination in chief? What is the scope of cross examination? What is the scope of re-examination? As I told you that examination in chief means it is examination of the witness by the party who calls into the court. What is the scope? The scope of examination in chief is, first scope is that whatever evidence or deposition he makes before the court, it must be relevant to the case. So a witness should speak about the relevant facts which are very relevant to the case. That is the first thing in examination in chief. Second thing is, unlike in a cross examination, leading questions cannot be put in examination in chief. Look here. Leading question means what? Leading question means a question which suggests an answer which the person expects to receive. That is a leading question. That means the question itself contains the answer. To understand this, look at the difference between these things. How many children you have? This can be a question in examination in chief. The answer for this question should come from the mouth of the witness. He must know how many children. On the other hand, say in leading question means you have two daughters and two sons. Is it so? So the answer itself contains that he has two daughters and two sons. The question itself contains the answers. Such questions are leading questions, where the answer should come from the mouth of the witness. So the witness must know the facts and he must depose. Such questions can be put in examination in chief. Of course, if it is not, court can permit leading questions under certain, that means which are introductory in nature. In the cause title, the name, address is given. It's very introductory in nature. Such questions court can permit even in examination in chief also. Or facts which are already proved or admitted, which does not require any evidence at all, which court is convinced that that fact is already, it stands proved, or which is not disputed. So a fact which is not disputed, or questions or answers which are introductory in nature, circumstances which are introductory in nature, or court feels the facts are already proved, in respect of those things court can permit even in examination in chief also to put leading questions. Barring that, if the opposite party objects, no, don't allow leading questions to be put in examination in chief, the court, it is only with the permission of the court. Court can judge, say, whether this objection is sustainable. Already it is, of course, the question is very simple. It is in the nature of introduction, or this fact is already proved, or it is an undisputed fact. Court must consider these things and then only permit to put leading questions in examination in chief. Otherwise, in examination in chief, everything, the answers to the questions must come from the mouth of the witness. Leading questions are not permitted in examination in chief if objected to. It is only with the permission of the court such questions can be put. That is the restraint with regard to putting of leading questions in examination in chief. Another thing, see any number of instances we have seen where the witness will not support the prosecution case, or the witness recites, or he is not prepared to tell the truth before the court at all. What is to be done? I have a particular party, a summoned a witness, thinking that witness will support his case. But the witness is not prepared to tell the truth to the court, or he is deviating from his earlier statement, or he is reciling from his previous statement. So then what is to be done? What is the power or the right of the party who calls the witness to the court if the witness is not supporting? Think, say a person signed a will and he is a star witness to the case, and he comes to the court and he is not telling, he just says, I don't remember, I have nothing to do, I don't anything. He is not telling the truth at all. He is deviating. He is not prepared to help the court, assist the court by giving proper evidence. Then what is to be done? Then Evidence Act provides that where the witness is summoned by a party, if he is reciling from his earlier statement, or if he is not telling the truth to the court, or he is evading to tell the truth, then court can permit even the witness, a party who has summoned the witness, to put questions, such questions which can be put in cross examination. This we call hostile. There is no word hostile used in the Evidence Act, but that is by practice. You see, we have developed this. Hostile witness means he is not telling the truth, he is lying before the court, he is reciling from his previous statements. Then court treats that witness as hostile witness and permits to cross examine that witness. But Evidence Act says it is possible even for the party who summons the witness before the court to give evidence also to put questions which can be put in the cross examination. Means his veracity can be tested, why he is lying before the court can be shown to the court, or some other witnesses can be examined. This man is corrupt, bribed, his position and status in life can be tested. All those things that can be done in cross examination can be done where the court feels that the witness is not helping the party who has summoned that particular witness to put questions which can be put in cross examination. Means everything opens up. That means whether he is telling whether he is not telling the truth, for what reason, why he is not telling the truth. So then what is the evidentiary value of this witness who is not prepared to tell the truth before the court? Even hostile witness evidence also courts have appreciated. Of course, at one point of time is not a trustworthy witness, an hostile witness who is not prepared to tell the truth, who is compelled to tell the truth, may not be a witness whose evidence can be relayed. But now it is not like that. For whatever purpose it can be used, even to corroborate, of course, maybe that the entire witness of that particular witness is not useful, but partly it is useful. For whatever purpose it can be used, his evidence cannot be discarded merely because he is treated as hostile or he is not telling the truth. If certain answers are elicited and which can be considered while considering the matter on merits, is even hostile witnesses evidence also can be looked into by the court for whatever purpose or whatever is the worth of that particular evidence. So that is the scope of examination in chief. Examination in chief, leading questions are normally not put, and if objected to by the other party, it cannot be put except with the permission of the court. That is one restraint. Second thing is, in examination in chief is confined to relevant facts. That's another thing. And where the witness is summoned by a particular party, if the witness will not support his case, then he can make a request to the court to treat the witness as an hostile witness and can cross examine the witness also. That is permissible. That's the scope of examination in chief. Now you look at the cross examination. This is really it is an art. Cross examination is an art. Whether it is in a civil case or a criminal case, you must elicit truth from the unwilling mind. And a person has come to the court not to tell the truth, or he is exaggerating things. You have to elicit answers from his mouth. Therefore, the scope of cross examination is very wide. In a sense, it is not limited or restricted to what is deposed in examination in chief. Because both cross examination and examination in chief must relate to relevant facts, no doubt about that. But the cross examination is not restricted to what is deposed in examination in chief. It can go beyond that. So, first thing is, the scope of cross examination is very wide, is not confined to what is deposed by the witness in examination in chief. Not that he has deposed this, therefore cross examine only on these aspects, don't go beyond that. No. So the purpose of cross examination is to elicit the truth, to extract the truth from the witness. One thing is, and it is an opportunity for the adverse party to take answers which support his case, which favors his case. It is an opportunity for the adverse party to test the veracity of the witness who is deposing before the court, to know what his position in life is, to know his status in life is, to know what kind of witness he is, to test his credibility. All this is possible in cross examination. Therefore, cross examination of a witness is really an art. Just one or two examples I can share with you. While introducing, it was told that I was representing case artist. It was an accident case. The witness injured had come to the court, and in civil court, that particular court, MUC court, it was in the sixth floor. And this man, the injured, came as a witness, and then he entered the witness box, oath was administered, and he deposed that he cannot move because of the accident. He has sustained fracture, it has resulted in disability, he is unable to move, and he has suffered a lot, there is a loss of earning, and it is only to assess the compensation he was deposing. And his main aim was to show to the court that he is unable to walk because of the injury sustained in the accident. Therefore, he was claiming compensation for a disability also, permanent disability. Then this must be tested. So, the cross examining counsel, he wanted to show that the witness is lying. Look at in the way cross examination was done. First, he put a question, how did you come from your house now? He said, in a BTS bus. Oh, fine. How did he come to sixth floor? The cross examining counsel expected him to say, by this man must say that how did he come to that he climbed. That was his thinking. He climbed means he is capable of walking. How did you come to sixth floor, to this court? I came by lift, he said. Then unfortunately, the judge was working in sixth floor on that day, because there was no light at all. The lifts were not operating on that day at all. The judge also came climbing. The only way to reach up to that is either somebody lives or he should climb and come there. Then the judge summoned that lift operator, please come and enter witness box. See, today there was no electricity at all, lifts were not operating. I have come by climbing. This man says that he came by lift. Give evidence whether lift were operating or not. The operator said, no, lifts were not operating, sir. There is no power, there is a power cut. And lifts are not operating since morning. Then he started sweating, the witness started sweating. And he collapsed, in fact, in the court. This is the power of cross examination. But for that, see, he would have just said that in any number of cases we have seen, in accident claims cases, suppose a man is capable of seeing, he says there is loss of eyesight. And sometimes even expert evidence also, they come and depose that this man has, because of the accident, he has suffered injury to the eye. And there is loss of eyesight, this is there, 30%, 20%, 50% disability. This helps in assessing the compensation, quantum of compensation for that. So that is the purpose of cross examination. The purpose of cross examination is to elicit the truth, to elicit the truth. And that is a weapon in the hands. That is why the second most important thing in cross examination is leading questions can be put in cross examination. It means it contains answers. The question itself contains answers. So look at this in a murder case. It was a Sessions trial. That witness claimed to be an eyewitness in a very heinous crime. And the question, he said that, sir, I witnessed the incident from my house. I witnessed the incident. My house is near to his, the deceased's house. The fight went on there. And ultimately, he was assaulted and he was killed by so-and-so. Then, in the cross examination, he was asked, how many houses are there in your village? Oh, so many, 400, 500 houses are there. So the deceased house is situated in a particular lane. Where is your house? My house is in some corner of the village. What is the distance? So it's about 1 kilometer or so. And then how many lanes come in between your house and the deceased house? 2, 3, 4, like that. Somebody stands in front of your house, he can't see what happens in this house. No, sir, he can't see that. So, a man, his veracity is tested like this. Now, you can say that whether he can be considered as an eyewitness or not, because the answer is that I saw the incident by standing near my house. His house is at a particular distance. Nobody can see that. This is how you can test the veracity of a witness in cross examination and elicit the truth. That is the power of cross examination. So, the second aspect, most important aspect of cross examination is the veracity, in cross examination, leading questions are permitted. Leading questions means questions which contain the answer straight away. You can say that there is no scope for Dale. Either he must accept it or not. Say, somebody has 3 children. Straight away it can be asked, not how many children. We need not ask like that. Straight away it can be asked that you have 3 children. 1 daughter, 2 sons, or 2 daughters, 1 son. Straight away you can answer. The question itself contains the answers. Whatever I wish to elicit, that can be done. That is possible in cross examination. That is the scope of cross examination. That is the most important thing, is leading questions are permitted in cross examination. And the next thing is scope of cross examination is, suppose previous statements are made under various circumstances. Say in Mahajar, it is recorded, FIR is lodged, dying declarations are made. When the injured goes to the hospital, he meets the doctor and tells the history of the case. In all these places, there is a prior statement made. Now, this statement is reduced into writing. How it can be used? So, section, this is a very, very important section, that section 145 of the Evidence Act, which speaks about the contradictions. So, if a witness can be cross-examined with regard to his previous statements, he need not be shown that statement. He need not be, that statement need not be proved also. But supposing the cross-examiner wants to contradict the witness, or with the permission of the court, the prosecution or the person who has summoned the witness wants to elicit contradiction, then this is the mode. This is the mode of proving contradiction. That particular portion which the party wants to contradict is evidence, it must be brought to the notice of that party, particular party. If he says, yes, I have stated like this in my previous statement, and today I am deposing totally a different thing, then the contradiction is proved in his evidence. That means he contradicts what is deposed before the court is totally different from what he has stated earlier. So the contradiction can be like this: two inconsistent statement by a same person with regard to a particular fact. So also there can be omissions sometime. Very important aspect. You see, insignificant omissions are of no consequence at all. There must be material omissions. Then if there is a material omission, and if that is proved by as a contradiction, that something which is omitted and for the first time the witness is deposing before the court, that is a contradiction by way of omission. So contradiction can be of two kinds. One, the statement made before the court is totally different from his previous statement. That's one way of proving contradiction. And another thing is, something very serious he has omitted in the first instance, he is deposing before the court. That must be material. So let's try some examples to understand this. You see, a witness comes before the court and deposes before the court, "Sir, I saw the incident, and the accused persons assaulted the deceased with a club." So this is his evidence before the court. Before the court, he says, he is an eyewitness to the occurrence, and the accused persons assaulted the deceased with the club. But in the course of investigation, his statement is recorded by the police, wherein he has stated that the accused persons came with knives and choppers and stabbed. Now you look at that. Before the court, he is changing the nature of weapon that is used in the commission of the crime. There is a total contradiction. What is stated by him before the court is totally different from what was stated in the first instance in the course of investigation. Therefore, if you want to prove contradiction, he comes and deposes before the court, say, "Sir, I saw the incident, accused persons assaulted the deceased with the club." Then, if you want to prove the contradictions, is the statement before the police officers, that particular portion. Look here, before the police you have stated, I saw the incident, the accused persons assaulted the deceased with choppers and knives. Because if the assault is with the club, the nature of injuries are totally different. If the assault is with the knife, the nature of injuries are totally different. If the assault is with the chopper, the nature of injuries is totally different. Therefore, if you prove contradiction like this, then the witness becomes unreliable. He is not a creditworthy witness at all. Therefore, you can elicit contradictions. So, to prove contradiction, you must always confront that particular portion which you want to contradict. To the supposing it is brought to the notice of the witness, that particular line, he says, yes, I have stated like this. Then you must put it to the IO who has recorded this statement. Has he stated like this? And then he must say whatever is there in his statement, that yes, he has stated before me that he was the accused persons assaulted with such and such a weapon. He will say that. You must prove it. That is proof of that particular statement. Suppose the witness himself admits that, okay, I have stated like that before the police. Now I am saying like this. Then the contradiction stands proved. That is the way to prove contradictions and omissions. Omissions, let us try this. What is this kind of omission? Say in the first information, the complaint is lodged after a few hours after the incident. In the complaint, what is stated is, at the time of the occurrence, there was only one witness. He saw the incident. So the complainant or the first informant, in his complaint has stated, the incident was witnessed by one eyewitness. Before the court, he adds one more name. Maybe he is not comfortable with that witness whom he has shown as witness in the first information. He may not support him. Now he says, there were two eyewitnesses, sir, and adds one more name while deposing before the court. Look here, before the in the first instance, when he lodged the first information, he has stated that there was only one eyewitness. Now he is improving his version and saying that there were two witnesses. That means that is an improvement made by him. You can elicit this contradiction. Look here, in your first information, this is what you have stated. It must be brought to that notice and prove the contradiction and make this witness, he is not a reliable man. One time he has said that there was only one witness. Now he is saying that there were two witnesses. Therefore, this witness is not a reliable witness at all. So therefore, the previous statements can be used in cross examination for the purpose of eliciting, for the purpose of cross examination. And if somebody wants to prove contradictions in the previous statements recorded or put in writing, then that particular portion must be brought to the notice of that particular witness and take his answer. That is how omissions and contradictions need to be proved in a criminal case. That is another area of cross examination, means cross examining a witness with reference to his previous statements. Now let's see the scope of cross examination. Why you are cross examining? To test the veracity of a witness, to test his position in life, his status in life, to impeach his character. That is the purpose of cross examination. All this can be done in cross examination. That means you can test the veracity. See, one example, we can say, a very close friend, two litigating parties are there, plaintiff and defendant. And plaintiff's friend is from a different village. Plaintiff brings that man to depose that he has grown. Some litigation is there. There is a dispute with regard to title and possession, and the plaintiff asserts that he has raised the crop and it is witnessed by this man, his friend. Now he comes and deposes before the court. My friend is in possession. He has been raising this crop. We had raised this one, that one, that one, that one. He deposes before the court. Now this is his examination in chief. Now how to cross-examine this witness? Now, first question. You are from which place? Oh, I am from a neighboring village. For him, how many houses are there in the in that particular village? There are many houses. So on the east of this man, plaintiff, such and such a person is there, he is owning land. West, such and such a person is owning land. And on the north, there is a road and people move, the people of that village move, walk through that road. On the southern, on the other side also, there is somebody else. You are his friend, very close friend. Since how many years you know him? I know him many years. So then, if you know that, look here, the man to depose that he has raised the crop is not bringing his neighbor or a person from his village who can naturally see him raising the crop. He brings somebody from some village. So if these things are there, he is the friend of this man and he has not a regular visitor to that land at all and he is from a different village. If these facts are elicited, that shows the veracity, whether this man can be believed at all. Has he really seen? So that is the way you can test the veracity of a witness. For example, an expert say, you put him a question, a doctor comes and deposes in a criminal case about the post-mortem, say. So I witnessed this, I saw these injuries, this death is due to so and so and then. Now you want to test the veracity of this, if you can. Doctor, when did you complete your MBBS? The doctor says, 2 years back. Oh. 2 years back. When were you appointed, doctor? Just about 6-8 months. You have no experience of conduct. This is perhaps the first postmortem you have conducted. No. 1 or 2 I have conducted postmortem. How did you do that procedure and other things? Now, this is to put the expertise and experience of this man. On the other hand, the doctor says, oh, I am serving as a doctor since 25 years. I have conducted hundreds of mortems like this. This is one among them. That is, look at the nature of answer there. Look at the nature of answer in this case. So that you can, to assess the, to test the veracity of a witness, whether he can be believed, to what extent he can be believed, to for all these things to elicit, to test the veracity, whether what he is telling is the truth. Sometimes we may feel like that, oh, everything is all right, he has come and deposed before the court. We can't go by that at all. We can't go by that. You have to test. Because one classic case, I don't, the other details I don't know, only I know the gist of the case was, it was a serious sessions trial. The incident occurred in the night. The witness deposed that the incident occurred in moonlight. I saw it in moonlight. There was no street light. He says that, how did you see the incident? I saw the incident in moonlight. And the counsel was able to show to the court that it was a Amavasya day. There was no moon at all on that particular day. This is what test the veracity of a witness. That means how truthful the witness is. Can he be believed at all? It is for this purpose, cross-examination is a greatest weapon, because the scope of cross-examination is very wide. You can attack a particular individual from different ways, whether what he is saying is a truthful version, or what is his status in life, Is he a related person? Is an interested person? Is a political enemy? So he is that the between two families, the litigation is going on since several years. What their position is, what their status in life is, then the witness, whether it is credible or not credible, it depends upon those circumstances. This is possible in cross examination. That means questions can be put to test the veracity of the witness, how truthful he is. Questions can be put, what is his status and position in life. Question can be put to impeach the character, even assuming that the questions put may criminate him sometimes. It may result in some criminal cases. Doesn't matter. Even it may result in penalty and forfeiture of his property. Even then also, to impeach the character, this man is not credible at all, he's an utter liar, to show that this weapon of cross-examination can be used. But friends, one change we must notice, one tremendous change, very important change that is made. See, in rape victims, we have seen how rape victims are cross-examined. And now, by law, there is an amendment. Either it may be a case of attempt to rape or outraging the modesty of a woman, or it may be a rape case. In all such cases now, friends, you cannot, you must depose only particular act, whether that act is a crime or not. You can't now lead evidence. Two things: neither you lead evidence nor you can put any questions to show that the lady was of immoral character, or she had a past sexual about her sexual experiences. You can't ask questions like, you can't lead evidence. Two things: independent evidence also you can't lead. Maybe she is a particular victim, is a person of immoral character. What of it? Does not mean somebody can venture to commit a heinous crime like that. That's a most important thing. Now, this is a very, very important thing, that neither evidence can be led nor any questions can be put to say that you are earlier, that was one of the that was a trump card, in fact, for that used to be the defense. Look here, this lady is a person of immoral character, or she had past sexual experiences, and therefore how can you believe that she is a consenting party, she is used to sexual intercourse. But now he says, go only by that act, particular act. Either you prove that act. And then there is corresponding amendment also saying that if a rape victim comes and deposes before the court that I was not a consenting party, court shall presume. Now look at the restriction now. Where sexual act is proved, this is the situation now, where sexual act is proved and the victim comes and deposes before the court, I was not a consenting party, the court shall presume. Then the burden shifts on the other side to show that she was a consenting party. To prove consent, or how good the consent or how bad the consent was, you cannot lead evidence to show the character of that lady. Regarding the character, that the past conduct, that she was a person of immoral character or she had past sexual experiences, even for that also no questions can be put at all. So consent means whether there was a consent for the act. You can't, by presumption, that this is a lady of immoral character, therefore it can be presumed that she has consented. That cannot be done now at all. Whether there was a consent, that particular act or not, is the question that is before the court. Even that also, if the lady victim, where sexual act is proved and she comes and deposes before the court that I was not a willing party or a consenting party at all, court shall presume that there was no consent. Then it is for the accused to show that to prove consent in whatever manner permissible law. That is the seriousness of that provision. That's a very important thing now. So that is the scope of cross examination in the case. Then how to impeach the character of a witness, how it can be done is the question now. Now, to impeach the character of a man or that the witness is not trustworthy, that can be done in different ways. One, by examining witnesses who know about the character of this person. So who come and depose before the court, this man is not a trustworthy person. He is not a creditworthy person at all. If somebody comes and deposes before the court that he is not a trustworthy witness, that is one way of showing to the court. Then by contradictions also. So even by proving, as already I told you, that witness is inconsistent, therefore his evidence cannot be believed. Or it can also be shown that this witness is won over, is bribed, and there is an offer of bribe. He has accepted the offer of bribe. He is a dishonest man. He has deliberately come to tell lie before the court. So if you can show that he is a corrupt man, or he has accepted the offer of corruption, or there is some inducement there, this witness, I will do this, I will do that, if you can come and depose in support in my favor, I will do this. If there is an inducement of that kind, then that witness is not creditworthy at all. That is how the credibility of the witness can be done in these three different ways. That means by examining persons who know about the witness and come and depose before the court that the witness is not a creditworthy witness, or that the witness is bribed, or he has accepted the offer, or there is some kind of inducement for him to come and depose before the court, or his evidence is full of contradictions. I told that contradictions, inconsistent statement, or by omission also, if that is proved, he is not a creditworthy man, because he is making different statements at different places, therefore he is not trustworthy witness at all. That is how you can impeach. That is possible in cross examination. So look at the scope of cross examination. It need not confine to relevant facts, what is deposed by the witness. It can go beyond. Of course, cross examination in toto must concern relevant facts, no doubt about that. But it need not confine itself what is deposed in examination in chief. It can go beyond that. Leading questions are permissible. Contradictions and omissions you can elicit. You can impeach the character. You can test the veracity of a witness. All this is possible in cross examination. That is all. And there is one more aspect in cross examination. Sometimes we know that we'll not stick on at all. Oral evidence, we give everything. See, you must study evidence act properly, because what facts need to be proved by a documentary evidence, what facts need to be proved by oral evidence is very clear, specific. So wherever a particular grant or disposition or contract is in writing, you can't prove them orally. When there is a grant, a contract or a disposition of property reduced into writing, somebody, you can't bring somebody and say that this was the contract. That very document must be produced for inspection of the court. Court should consider that only. So unless secondary evidence is permissible, say a witness comes and he is about to make a statement about something where a contract or a disposition, say a property is sold or by will it is willed away. So there, if the witness comes and to depose or to give oral evidence, that is not permissible in law, because when there is a when a grant, contract or a disposition of property is made by a document, it is that document which evidences that transaction, not any other thing. That is excluded. Oral evidence is excluded unless secondary evidence is permissible. So then The party can simply ask that witness, see, is not that contract or disposition of property is done by in writing, or there is a document for that evidencing that transaction? If the witness says yes, till that document is produced, nothing can go. Or the witness who come must make out a ground to produce secondary evidence. Then only the witness can be allowed to produce secondary evidence, otherwise not. So therefore, in such cases also, a cross examiner can say that this is not permissible at all. He can raise an objection saying that this grant, this contract, this disposition of property has happened by means of a document. Therefore, oral evidence to the exclusion of is not permissible in law. Or the witness who has come to depose must first make out a ground why oral evidence is adduced in the place of documentary evidence. So unless he makes out a ground to produce secondary evidence, oral evidence is not permissible. That objection also can be raised. So these are the scope of cross examinations. There are, see, any number of cases, because cross examination is an art. It all depends. Every one of us will experience a thrill while conducting criminal cases or civil cases like that, because of this weapon of cross examination. So it is only to elicit the truth. The scope of it must be properly known. Then next question is about re-examination. Examination in chief, cross examination, and re-examination. Look at the limits of re-examination. It only says that the re-examination is only for the purpose of explaining the matters referred to in cross examination. That's all the purpose. No other purpose. So it is only to explain. That means for purpose of clarity, for the purpose of removing ambiguity. So that to remove that confusion, whatever matter is referred to in cross examination, re-examination should confine only to that. Whatever he has deposed in examination in chief is there evidence, nothing. But whatever is referred to in cross examination, and some clarity is required, that can be explained. What do you say for this? If that is put to him, then he must explain that. See, sometimes it may so happen that while re-examination, some new fact may be introduced. It is possible. While as an answer, as a by way of explanation, when something is explained, it may be in the nature of introducing a new fact, then opportunity should be given to the adverse party to cross-examination and for cross-examination on that aspect. So that is how it has done. Now, what can be done in cross examination? Sometimes humiliation is there to annoy a person. Questions are scandalous, questions, indecent questions are put. All these are possible. Now, it is for the court in a because the cross examination is not confined, and even circumstances which can criminate a man also, such questions, uncomfortable questions, can be put to a witness in cross examination, merely because he is going to suffer something or he may be prosecuted. That is not a ground at all. But if they are relevant to the fact in issue, indecent and scandalous questions, court can forbid. See, if they are unnecessary, only just to defame a man, if it is done, there is no substance in the questions, court can forbid. But if those questions are very relevant to the fact in issue, very relevant to consider for the court to make decision, they are helpful, then court can, unless they are relevant to the fact in issue. In all other circumstances, court can forbid somebody from putting indecent and scandalous questions. But if they are relevant to the case, they're concerned with the facts in issue, then irrespective of the nature of the question, they should be allowed to be put. Similarly, to annoy a man, humiliate a man, many questions are put. Then also court can forbid that unless they are very essential. Maybe even to certain extent, maybe they are relevant. But if they are not vital, they are not required at all, court can forbid the cross examiner from putting questions which are which can annoy a man. That is not permissible. It can say don't put those questions at all, but it depends upon the circumstances of a case. Cross examination I was reading, it's a beautiful cross examination. You know, Ram Jethmalani was perhaps one of the most leading lawyers of our country. Any number of cases, most serious cases of our country are conducted by him. He was cross-examined. He was a witness in one case. Very recently, I was listening to a lecture. There, that counsel who conducted cross-examination of Ram Jethmalani was telling me. And he was asked some questions. Ram Jethmalani came there and he was very, very... we know them. We have seen Ram Jethmalani. He was a very upright person, and even cross examiner counsel also has highest regard for him. But he put a question. He was asking in connection with some Ms. Jethmalani, what's your residential address? My residence at Bombay, for my professional work, I am staying at Delhi. Oh. For your residence, you are staying at Bombay. For your professional work, you are at Delhi. Now, you are a Rajya Sabha member, Mr. Jethmalani, from Karnataka. I am a Rajya Sabha member. Oh, what is the residential address you have given, Jethmalani? Jethmalani started said, Bangalore. Oh, you have given in your form, you have filled that you are residing at Bangalore, isn't it? Look here, this can annoy a man. Question, but court allowed this question. And that changed, that had a lot of impact on the entire story. Credibility. So, he stays at Bombay and he's staying at Delhi. He becomes a Rajya Sabha member and he gives a wrong address. And he wants the court to believe his statements. So this is how cross examinations go. That is the importance of cross examination. It's an art. It will not come. It only comes by experience. Lot of reading we can make, but that will not. You must stand there and cross examine a witness. You must handle the witness. Then only you learn. Otherwise, maybe sometimes, by our cross examination, we lose the cases. They have a serious repercussions also. Wrong questions we put to some experts. We behave like experts and put questions, and all questions go against us, and then we start searching here and there. That is also possible, but cross examination is an art, and it should be mastered only by experience. By our, see, so many things, sometimes we fall down and then rise up. By it's only a sheer experience, we must gain that experience, knowledge. That's about cross examination. So, the scope of re examination I explained to you, it is only to explain the matters. It's a very limited scope. And sometimes we have seen that all kinds of questions that should not be done. If you know the limits of these scope of examination in chief, the scope of cross examination and scope of re-examination, then only we can confine to within our bounds. Otherwise we just we crisscross the areas, either then it becomes a difficult thing. Only record becomes voluminous without any substance. Therefore If we know the limits of these things, then we can be straight onto the point. And in only one example, I will give you importance of cross examination. And anybody wants to participate on 26th, I am speaking on the topic of cross examination only on that topic. On that day, you can participate. But now, one important aspect. See, it was the man was charged. The accused was charged for an offence of murder, 302. And the charge was for an offence punishable under section 302 IPC. The cross examination. Nodi, look at this. The nature of preparation that is required to cross examine under. What was elicited in the cross examination was that he sustained injuries in the incident. He did not die. The death was not instantaneous. He was taken to the hospital. He survived for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. Then he died. The injured died. In the post-mortem report, the death was due to, because he was operated, complications that developed in the course of treatment. Septicemia. We call it septicemia. So now he has caused injury. The man has caused injury, no doubt. And it has resulted in the death also. But the direct cause of death is not the injuries caused by the person. It is because of the treatment complications which developed in the course of treatment. This fact was elicited. Now what happens? The court considered this. Therefore, the man did not die because of the injuries sustained in the incident. He died because of the treatment complications. Therefore, the death is not relatable to the conduct of the accused. What accused caused was only injuries. Therefore, he can be punished for grievous assault, not for death. So now the charge of murder is reduced to grievous hurt, not even culpable homicide. That's the scope of cross examination. So these are a few tips I am speaking of. So that is how you have to cross examine. We will now go to the last part. The last part is whether witness can refresh. Supposing doctors are there, investigation officers are there, engineers or public officers, say they can't remember everything at all. So they are transferred from places to places, and then they deal with hundreds of cases. Then for what is the scope of this refreshing the memory? So any such witness who comes before the court, if something is in his handwriting or it is in somebody's handwriting and this man has read when it was recorded and he knows that it is truthful, or the original is lost, the copy is available, witness can refresh his memory. That is permissible. So we must understand this. See, look at the law. What is to be done? I can't remember. Say I am an inspector of police, or as a superintendent, a circle inspector of police. I have investigated hundreds of cases. Everything I can't remember. Therefore, I can only speak by record. Refresh my memory. Is it permissible for a witness to? Yes, it is permissible for a witness to refresh memory by three different ways. One, what is in his handwriting? He himself has recorded. He can look to that and refresh it. Second thing is, recorded by somebody else, but witness has seen it and it was truthful when it was made. Third thing is, copy of that document is original is lost. It is proved that original cannot be produced, it is not available. Then he can look to the copy of that document. Not only that, he can refresh his memory. All right, I remember. Oh, gotait anta helti nan adu ondu adanne nodkonde heladu. Suppose accident register is there, I looked to the accident register, refreshed my memory, and from my memory I depose is one thing. I looked to the accident register, relay upon the register and depose. That is also permissible. Two things can happen. Witness can refresh his memory by referring to the documents if it is in his writing, or the writing has happened and he has seen it and he knows that the contents are true, or the copy of the document, and from those documents not only he can refresh his memory, he can also depose to the contents also. That is, but the consequence is this: all those things, when once it is used to refer, that must be brought to the notice of the opposite party, adverse party. All these things, whatever is relayed upon by the prosecution or whoever, plaintiff side or what, all those things to use it to refresh the memory must be brought to the notice and must be available to the opposite party, and the adverse party can cross examine if he so chooses. That is permissible in court. So that opportunity of cross examination, that is another opportunity for the cross examiner. That is another thing. And now sometimes witness only comes now. Witness only comes to produce a document. Witness is summoned. Accident register kodri. Ashte heltare ashte. Avanu accident register nalli en bardide, yaar bardide gottilla. He is in charge of the accident register. And he produces the accident register. Or from some tahsildar's office or assistant commissioner office, some records are summoned. He produces the record. He will not come as a witness at all. So any person who is summoned only as a witness for the production of the document cannot be cross-examined. The moment he produces the document, it is over. But if he is summoned as a witness to produce the document as well as to depose to the contents, then only he can be subjected to cross-examination. Merely if a witness is summoned to produce the document, the moment it is produced, that is over. Therefore, that is the limit of that. So now notice is issued. The document is in the custody of somebody else. Adverse party issues notice. Look here, this document is with you. You please produce a document. And he produces the document. This man inspects. The party who has summoned the document inspects that document. And then he decides, ಇದೇ ನಂಗೇನು ಬೇಕಾಗಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ. ಈ ಕೆನಾಟ್ ಸೇ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್. ವೆನ್ ಒನ್ಸ್ ಎ ಪಾರ್ಟಿ ಟು ದಿ ಪ್ರೊಸೀಡಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಸಮನ್ಸ್ ದಿ ಡಾಕ್ಯುಮೆಂಟ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ದಿ ಅಡ್ವರ್ಸ್ ಪಾರ್ಟಿ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದಿ ಅಡ್ವರ್ಸ್ ಪಾರ್ಟಿ ರೆಸ್ಪಾನ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸಸ್ ದಟ್ ಡಾಕ್ಯುಮೆಂಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಲೇಟರ್ ಆನ್ ಈ ಕಾಂಟ್ ಸೇ ದಿಸ್ ಕೆನಾಟ್ ಬಿ ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಎಸ್ ಎವಿಡೆನ್ಸ್. ಇಟ್ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಇಫ್ ದಿ ಪಾರ್ಟಿ ಇನ್ಸಿಸ್ ದಿ ಪಾರ್ಟಿ ಹೂ ಪ್ರೊಡ್ಯೂಸಸ್ ದಿ ಡಾಕ್ಯುಮೆಂಟ್ ಇನ್ಸಿಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಎಸ್ ಎವಿಡೆನ್ಸ್, ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ನೋ ಆಪ್ಷನ್, ಇಟ್ ಶುಡ್ ಬಿ ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಎಸ್ evidence, that can be taken as evidence. This is one way where the document is produced. Suppose a person is in possession of a document, he is summoned to produce a document, notice is issued, please produce a document in your custody. That is not done. He refuses to produce. Then that man who has refused to produce cannot use that document. One good illustration is given. He cannot use that document later and say, I want to use that document. He cannot. Either the consent of the party is required or court order. It's only with the court order he can produce the document which he has refused to produce or notice to produce. That one, for example, is say an agreement is there between the parties. The original is the somebody, opposite party. And he is summoned to produce the agreement. He refuses, no, I don't produce that document. Do whatever you like. And the party who has summoned adduces secondary evidence. Look here, sir, it is in his custody, he is not producing the original. I may be permitted to adduce secondary evidence, I will produce it. He produces the secondary evidence. Later on, he cannot come and say, sir, the secondary evidence, there are some mistakes in the secondary evidence or some exaggerations, it is not true, a truthful version. He cannot say, I use the original. Having lost the opportunity to produce the document, he cannot come round and say that unless the opposite, the party who has summoned consents or court passes an order. That is the scope of non-production of a document when summoned. Now, last section 165 is about the court's power to that. So now we have seen any number of judgments. Courts cannot be spectators. All right, you go on putting examination, you do this, that. Court cannot be mere spectator. It can play an active role. It can participate in the proceedings. Enormous power is given to the court under section 165 of the Evidence Act. Court's concern is to do justice, to elicit the truth. In support of the facts in issue or relevant facts, it can put any question, any time to any witness. Look at the power of the court. Any question, any time to any person, and nobody can question that. Why you are putting that question? It may be relevant, even irrelevant question. But decision making should be based on relevancy. Relevant evidence only should be the basis for decision. But questions can be put by the court to any party. Nobody can, unless court permits them to cross-examine. Somebody is examined as court witness. Unless court permits to cross-examine, that cannot happen. So therefore, this is an enormous power is given to the court to put any kind of questions to any witness at any time. So also to summon documents. Any document can be summoned. They are bound to produce. But the restriction is what is contained from 118 to 134. What is there? The restrictions, these privileged communications, documents relating to state affairs or public office documents, or privileged comes like a lawyer and as between husband and wife, or clients and attorney, lawyer. So those communications are privileged communications. They cannot be compelled to answer something which is not permissible in law. And sometimes a witness cannot be summoned to compelled to produce a document if he refuses. He cannot, unless the witness himself has agreed, yes, when you summon, I will produce the document. He cannot be compelled. A witness cannot be compelled to produce a document. Subject to those restrictions, so also court can also cannot put indecent and scandalous questions. Just whatever is applicable to the witnesses is applicable to the court. Subject to that restriction, court has ample power to put whether relevant or irrelevant questions, but decision making should be based on what is admissible and relevant facts only, not inadmissible evidence. That is the thing. And the last section, 167, deals with reversal of the judgments. Whether a judgment can be reversed because something is not received in evidence, or something is rejected, or something is not accepted, or improperly admitted in evidence. So improper admission or improper rejection, whether that can be a ground, a shelter. In the normal circumstances, if the decision that is made is permissible based on other material, say some evidence is improperly recorded or received, it is improperly received, but even that is excluded, that improper evidence is excluded, the decision can be still sustained, then court need not order for retrial, or it need not reverse its decision. Similarly, say there is an improper evidence which is refused, court ought to have received that evidence. Even if that evidence is received, if that is also considered, decision is not going to vary. Then in those circumstances, improper admission or improper rejection of evidence is not a ground to reverse the decision, order for retrial. So these are the various aspects of examination of witnesses. And of course, this is only a lecture. It's only by practice. We must go there, practice, and conduct many cases and learn by experience. Any amount of teaching will not help. It can only show you the way. That is all the limited purpose of this lecture. And I am grateful to the institution for this opportunity. Now it is time for me to say thank you all, sirs.
Thank you so much, sir, for such an informative talk. I would now like to call Shri Nidhi from fourth semester LLB to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Gayatri. Colin Paul once said, there are no secrets to success. It is the result of preparation, hard work, and learning from failure. On this note, a very good afternoon to one and all present here. I, Shri Nidhi, am honored to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of the entire campus. Let me first start by thanking Almighty for making this session possible. I would like to extend my most sincere gratitude to our Honorable Chief Guest, Justice Mr. H. Billappa, sir, for lending your valuable time besides your busy schedule. By providing us with your knowledge and insights about the overview to examine the witness, we understood the depth and importance of the subject. And as you had mentioned, how important it is for a witness to understand the questions asked and to reciprocate it back. You had further mentioned about the scope of examination on how relevant the evidence should be and further explained the importance of different types of examination and mainly about cross-examination and re-examination. And by giving us real-life examples, this session was even more interesting, sir. It was truly inspiring and helpful for all of us, and as future lawyers, this session was very informative and has helped us gain more insights about the importance of witness examination in criminal justice system. I thank you once again, sir, for your kind words. I thank our Honorable Dean, Dr. T.R. Subramania, sir, for giving us this opportunity to be a part of this wonderful session. And a special thanks to our Vice Principal, Vijay Praneshwaran, sir, the dignitaries of the school and the faculties of CMR. And last but not the least, I take this opportunity to thank all the students present here for being patient throughout the session. Thank you, sir.
So nice. Namaste, sir. Namaste. So nice, sir. So nice.